So I'm excited to talk to our guest today. Let's get him on the line. Okay, so his name is John M. Barry. And John Barry, back in 2004, wrote a book called The Great Influenza, the story of the deadliest pandemic in history. And he was named, it was named the year's outstanding book on science or medicine by the National Academies of Sciences. John Barry is also an adjunct professor at Tulane University School of Public Health and Tropical Medicine. And he just wrote an op-ed for the New York Times, last month. The title was, "Will Warm Weather Slow Coronavirus?" He wrote an op-ed for the Washington Post back in January that asked, can this virus be contained? Probably not. Long before, our government was warning us about it. So I'm thrilled to welcome John Barry to the show. John, you there?
I am. Thanks.
Thank you so much for joining us today. You wrote this book back in 2004, so this is a topic you're very familiar with, yes?
Pretty much so, and for the last 16 years, I've been involved in pandemic preparedness planning and so forth. The Bush administration launched a very substantial effort, $7 billion worth, and part of that was a planning process that I was asked to participate in.
Right. In fact, both the Bush and Obama administrations sought your advice on preparedness for just such an event as we're experiencing now, right?
That's true, yeah.
I know it doesn't need to be said, but I'll ask it anyway. Have you ever gotten a call from anyone in the Trump administration?
No. I do know some members of the task force and have had some slight communication with them, the professionals. But from any political appointee, no.
Now there was a pandemic response team or a prevention team in place, I guess, inside the National Institutes of Health or the Center for Disease Control. I'm not sure where it would have been, but it was put into effect during the Obama administration, right? And this is something that Trump shut down.
Yeah, that was the National Security Council.
Oh, okay.
They created that, believe me, the CDC has a very active group of people who focus on this. NIH is more pure science and research, but, Tony Fauci, of course, is at NIH.
Mm-hmm.
And, I mean, they know what they're doing.
They do, but it seems, and again, I'm just an average woman who has no idea how the CDC runs, the National Institutes of Health, any of it. We're all being educated as we go through this madness, but it just seems like we learned early on through this pandemic that the Trump administration shut down the office that was tasked with preventing such an outbreak. Were you aware when that happened, when they shut down that office?
I think it was it November? I'm trying to remember. I can't remember. but it was prior to the pandemic.
Right.
It might have been 2018. I did know a few people in that office. A lot of the National Security Council staff is more or less permanent professional staff. Many of them go from one administration to the next. This should be nonpartisan. The Bush administration, as I said, launched a very significant initiative. In fact, I remember at the time they were being accused of emphasizing pandemic preparedness to distract from scandals with Karl Rove and leaks about Valerie
Plame, right?
Plame, uh-huh. and questions about it. Then, of course, Obama built on that. Bush had established a national stockpile, invested in vaccine manufacturing technology and capabilities, done all sorts of things. And Obama did build on that, handled the what turned out to be a minor pandemic, H1N1,
right,
in 2009, then Ebola and so forth. You know, there are professionals. Bush and Obama listened to the scientific and public health community, and obviously this White House has done a little bit less so, less of that.
A lot less of it. I mean, what Trump's, I guess what, how he tried to defend his move, he's like, I don't want to pay people for sitting around and doing nothing. We can bring them all back. But that's not how it works, right? Once a pandemic has let loose on the planet, it's a little late to play catch up, right? I mean, these kinds of commissions, these kinds of teams that are in place are there for prevention, to help fend it off before it starts. And one of the big problems that me as an onlooker basically realized that the Trump administration screwed up so horribly at the beginning when they brought in, they were people who were on a ship who they knew were infected. They sent in a team of, I guess, doctors and officials to go meet with these people without any protective gear, without any protective anything. And then when they left the ship, they just went on their merry way. Isn't that the recipe for spreading a pandemic?
Well, I mean, the numbers there are relatively insignificant. Hmm. But, you know, there were, you know, thousands of people, several tens of them.
Uh-oh.
From China to the United States, even after the supposed embargo on people coming from China was imposed, there were still many, many people coming. You know, it was, you know, they just missed the opportunity.
Right.
And they continue to miss the opportunity. You know, it's still a debacle here in the United States on testing and tracing. We are way behind not just the Asian countries, who maybe had been sensitized because of SARS, and reacted very quickly and very aggressively, but, you know, also countries like Germany and Austria, that have done a pretty good job of getting ahead of this thing and reopening in a rational, with testing in place, with contact tracing in place, and we're just not ready at this point.
No, and it's apparent even to people who don't work in the medical field or don't know, you know, the ins and outs as you do. Again, John Barry is with us. You wrote the book in 2004 called The Great Influenza, the story of the deadliest pandemic in history. I know it's still too early to say it, but do you think the 1918 Spanish flu will turn out to be a bigger threat?
Oh, yeah. Then, fortunately.
Yes? Okay.
Fortunately, yeah. You know, that killed 50 to 100 million people.
Whoa.
In a world population less than 25% the size of today. So if you adjust for population, that would be equivalent to, you know, 220 to 440 million people.
Oh, my
today.
God.
In a worst case, we are not looking at anything like that, thank God.
Now, is that because it's not as severe an illness, or is it because we're better prepared to fight it?
Yeah. No, the number one thing is the virus. This virus is not nearly as virulent as 1918.
Wow.
On the other hand, this virus is actually more contagious than 1918. So it's going to infect more people. But again, fortunately, the case fatality rate, which we still don't know but it's going to be much, much, much lower than 1918.
Well,
You know, we still don't know what the number of deaths are likely to be, but it's not gonna be anything like that, thank God.
What do we need to know about the 1918 Spanish flu that maybe a lot of us don't know who are sitting here freaking out over COVID-19? What you wrote a whole book on it, so it's hard to, you know, narrow it down. But what don't we know about it?
The two biggest lessons. And the two are related. You know, I said earlier in the preparedness, the meetings to develop plans for a pandemic and mitigating a pandemic, which started in the Bush administration, you know, I did participate in those. The message that I carried to every meeting was tell the truth. I never got any back. That the idea of transparency is written, literally written into the, and it's written into every single state plan. But you still have to have someone who's going to go out there and execute the plan. You know, football coaches always talking about the plays failed because we didn't execute. It's the same thing. Doesn't matter how good your plan is. If you don't execute it properly, it's not going to work. And if you don't tell the truth, if you're not transparent, when you ask the public to do something, compliance that will yield maximum results. So you have a mixed message coming out of the White House for several months and misleading messages even after Trump started to take this seriously. And the result is you get a security guard killed when he's asked someone to put a mask.
A dollar store clerk getting killed for asking someone to put a mask on.
And you have people not complying with the recommendations because for 2 months, the White House trivialized the pandemic, made it seem like a partisan attack on the administration. I don't believe any other president in American history would have reacted as this guy has.
No.
It's incomprehensible.
No. And so I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Go ahead.
I was going to say, you talk in the editorial you wrote for the New York Times about, and what you just said, that the most important thing is transparency, being honest with the American people so we know what's going on. He runs with a different playbook. He doesn't believe in being honest. He even said in an interview or somebody the other day, my job is as the cheerleader for America. Well, no, it isn't. We don't need a cheerleader. We need somebody to be honest with us and tell us what the hell's going on. And again, we've gotten...
I think the worst thing he said, you know, to me, the worst thing he said was, you know, not, you know, let's go out and take this drug that turns out to be dangerous. It may have some benefit, but it's got plenty of downsides, too. Mm-hmm. When he said that the federal government, he's a backup to the states. I always thought leadership meant you got out front.
Mm-hmm.
That's what leadership is. I couldn't imagine somebody like Teddy Roosevelt or Franklin Roosevelt not taking charge and getting out front and handling this.
Right.
And being straight, you know, but he is what he is.
No, and the other thing is the way he plays the blame game. The line that he keeps repeating over and over again, that the Obama administration left him with a failed test that doesn't work. The COVID-19 didn't exist. There was no test for it. Do you know what he's talking about?
I don't know what he's talking about most of the time.
No, nor do I. No, but in this case, he's saying the reason we were late with the test was because the Obama administration left us with a broken testing system. That's just flat out not true. And again, I know the media isn't your area of expertise, but I scream at why doesn't anybody call him out on that when he says blatantly false statements like that? That's what frustrates me to no end. I'm sure other things frustrate you, like, you know, telling people to take a drug that has not been tested or approved. Or I can only imagine your reaction when you heard him talking about UV light and disinfectant injecting into the body to kill the virus.
Well, that one, I think everybody, that one.
Yeah. Yeah. So now with the doctors that are on the task force, which again he was going to shut down yesterday, but is back today, thankfully. Dr. Fauci, you have confidence in him? You feel good about him?
Oh yeah. I know him. I don't know him well, but I certainly know him, and we have mutual friends. I have very high regard for Tony.
Uh huh. And what about Dr. Birx?
I don't know her personally. She seems pretty good. One of the things that disturbs me is that CDC has largely disappeared from this.
Yes.
And CDC, I think, should be playing a much larger role. But, you know, I'm just, you know, so frustrated. I don't even know what to say here, you know, as you are. I think the important thing to get out to your audience, you know, rather maybe than browbeating Trump as, you know, as much as he deserves it, is that we do have some control over what happens. And you have some control over what happens to you personally. That social distancing does, in fact, work. You know, wearing masks is helpful. None of these things are, in and of themselves, going to solve the problem for either an individual or a society. But the whole idea is you layer these things, and one thing may only be 10% effective, another thing, another 10% effective, another thing, another 10% effective. But if you do all of them, then you add up to a pretty significant degree of protection. You know, what I was talking about earlier, executing, coach football for a while, so that's kind of implanted in my mind. You know, it goes back to the discipline to do the right thing every time. The very first meeting on planning for pandemics and so-called non-pharmaceutical interventions, what do you do when you don't have any drugs? The very first meeting, meeting the infection control chief for the hospital in the world on protecting healthcare workers during SARS. During SARS, many, many healthcare workers died. And what he told us was, and many of them ended up infecting themselves when they took off their personal protective equipment, their PPEs. And everybody knew what to do and how to take them off. What he told us at this first meeting was that his hospital had the best record in the world, because he made sure people did it the right way every time. It just came down to discipline, sustained compliance. It gets very, very tedious to wash your hands for at least 20 seconds. And people get sloppy.
And now
don't get sloppy. I mean, if you do it the right way all the time, a difference. And you can protect yourself. You know, it's not an absolute lock. It's not a guarantee, but it helps. And so does the mask.
And staying at home. But now, so people were pretty good for a month, But now all of a sudden the president's order for his stay-at-home order for the month of April is over. It's now May. And people are taking that. Oh, can you hear me? I know our connection is kind of shaky today. Can you hear me now? No?
Yeah, I think.
Hopefully it'll stay. Or I could try calling you back and see if we could better get a better connection.
Well, unfortunately, my cell phone took a swim the other day.
Oh, I see.
So
all right.
We're stuck with this landline.
We'll soldier through. So anyway, the but now they're lifting the stay-at-home orders in places where even after they put down, you know, the different levels of how to open society back up again, nobody is meeting the benchmarks. It's supposed to be 2 weeks of a downward slope in cases. And nobody has gone through 2 weeks of a downturn in the number of cases, but they're opening up nonetheless. And what do you say to people? What advice would you give? You're staying at home now? What are you personally doing?
Well, you know, I'm not locked in. I live in the French Quarter in New Orleans. New Orleans is a hot spot.
Yes, it is.
You know, I still, you know, take a few walks a day with my wife. You know, we're both over 70, so we're pretty vulnerable. Fortunately, we have friends who are younger who have volunteered to go to the grocery store for us and stuff. If there's a bright spot in what's happening, it's that I do get a sense that people are trying to help each other. You know, that's anecdotal, but it's certainly the feeling I have here in New Orleans. I have a neighbor who's a dentist who, you know, 6 weeks ago, as soon as this thing got serious here and they closed down, went to the local hospital and donated all gloves to the hospital. He's also, although he's a dentist, he took a a cycle as a resident in a hospital, a rotation.
Right.
And so he's capable of performing a lot of tasks, and he's volunteered to do that, to take the strain off other healthcare workers. So, you know, that kind of spirit is pretty inspiring, frankly.
Absolutely. No, and we see a lot of that.
For 15 years, I gave speeches and presentations saying one thing we don't know. When we get another pandemic in 1918, if you were in healthcare, you knew you were going to face infectious disease because a lot of people died from infectious disease. Today, that's not very common. So the question was, would a healthcare worker risk by taking care of people in a pandemic? If they had the courage, what about risking taking a pathogen home to their family?
Yeah.
And that question has been answered in the affirmative. Yes, they are, and that's inspirational. They really are heroes, and so are the grocery clerks.
Yes, they are.
Who are not exactly well paid.
No. So, John...
In terms of inspiration, they're... Go ahead.
No, I was going to ask, how did they finally eradicate the 1918 Spanish flu? How did that end? Obviously we're more medically advanced now, a century later. What did they do, or did it just have to run its course? I know you said that there was a much more virulent second wave, and do you think we're expecting that coming this fall?
Well, in 1918, the second wave was much more lethal than the first wave, no comparison. But that virus is very different. The influenza virus mutates very rapidly. This virus is quite stable. I don't think we have to worry about this virus changing virulence and becoming more deadly. In 1918, they did impose controls, social distancing, and so forth. Cities that did that the longest, the best results economically, as well as in terms of so-called flattening the curve. It turns out that a year or two later, their economies were in better shape than the ones that did not do that. But in terms of getting past it, it did pretty much run its course. The second, third time around, your immune system is better able to fight the disease than it. And it's the first time your immune system has seen it. In addition, I think in the influenza virus, again, as I said earlier, it mutates very rapidly. I think it probably mutated in a direction of most influenza viruses, which is, it can be fairly serious, but it's not like the killing wave of the fall of 1918. This thing... If we get a vaccine, and most people are pretty, the virologists are pretty optimistic that we will, largely because this virus does not mutate that rapidly and is pretty stable, so you know the target you're aiming at. If we, let's hope that sooner rather than later, and it's very effective, and that will, of course, interrupt the disease. Otherwise, it will probably just keep on trucking until it infects 60-70% of the population. If it does that, there's going to be a pretty high death toll.
Yeah. Well, there is already, and we're still seeing it. And I mean, it blows my mind that people are taking to the streets in some places, arguing that, that they're being given advice to try to protect themselves and save them from getting this horrible disease and possible death. But they want to go out and do what they're going to go out and do. What if you got a call, John Barry, say from somebody from Mike Pence's office, because he's still ostensibly running the task force, I guess. And he asked, what one piece of advice would you give us? What would you tell us to do to mitigate the horrible results that we're seeing? What would you tell them?
Well, I mean, it wouldn't be one piece. It'd be two.
Okay.
You know, again, tell the truth and continue the social distancing. I am not saying that, you know, you lock down the economy indefinitely.
Mm-hmm.
There are really, really serious costs that go with that, and there's a lot of pain and suffering that goes with that. But you don't come out of it the way we're coming out of it. You first thing you got to do is, for crying out loud, finally get the tests in, you know, where they should have been a week ago, if not months ago.
Right.
You know, do that right. Put the contact tracing in place. You know, build that infrastructure. A lot of people, and there are plenty of unemployed people with abilities who can be trained to do that. Here in Louisiana, the goal is once we unlock here, and the Louisiana governor has been pretty conservative. On May 1st, he extended it for another couple of weeks.
And in
New Orleans, we actually have a pretty steep downward curve.
Things are
actually much better here in New Orleans. But I know their goal is to identify all new, you know, contact every positive test within 75% of the positive tests within 24 hours, and then contact 75% of their contacts within the next 24 hours. You know, that's target to aim for, and I think that's achievable. If you did something, if you create the infrastructure to do that, and they're trying to build it here, if you do that here, if you do that in other states, you know, then you have a fighting chance of keeping this thing reasonably under control. It's not going to be stamped out. That's not going to happen. Instead of having, well, in the op-ed I wrote, to use the same language, if we do it right, you'll have a growing, sort of undulating swells, not so much a wave. You'll have swells with an occasional angry white cap breaking open. If you do it right, there is going to be, even if you do it right, there's going to be an uptick. But if you do it wrong, and again, borrowing from, you know, being in New Orleans and so forth, then you're going to get a hurricane storm surge of cases. And that's going to wipe out everything that you've gained from the sacrifices that have been made so far.
Wow.
You know, right now, it's varying state to state. We're still not getting the leadership we need to out of the White House. I don't have really, forget about optimism.
Mm-hmm.
I don't have any hope that that's going to happen. But there is some good leadership from some governors.
Yes.
And possibly their examples may make sense of other states force their own governors to start doing things right.
Well, we can hope.
It may be too late. It may not be too late. It's still too early to say.
Yes. Well, you know, hopefully people will heed the advice of the experts like you and continue to take precautions. I mean, some restrictions are lifted. Some people are going back to work. But it's still really important that we maintain the social distancing, that you wear the mask, that you have protections in place. Because, as you said, this is very, very contagious and it is deadly. And there's no cure yet and there's no vaccine yet. Are you confident that we'll have medication to help the symptoms and a vaccine that will protect us in the future?
Well, I'm not sure I'm use the word confident, but I'm pretty optimistic. And as a general rule, I'm a pessimist. So.
Okay. Well, you do have a website, johnmberry.com, that has links to all your books. And The Great Influenza, again, was written in 2004. More pertinent now than it's been probably since, and still available and worth your reading. John Berry, thank you so much for joining us today. I appreciate your insight.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Thanks so much. You too. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.